I'll do what it takes, whatever it takes.
Hello and welcome back to the United Devils podcast. My name is Arjun. Over these series of podcasts, we'll be discussing everything Manchester United and the Premier League in general. In this, we'll be looking at United's disastrous few games against Burnley and Liverpool, as well as looking ahead to the end of the transfer window and the FA Cup match against Tranmere Rovers and the second leg of the semi-final against Man City. With me today, welcome back, Jayson, and we're going to go straight into it and start slamming Manchester United and pretty much everyone in the club right now. So 2-0 against Liverpool. We go into this game knowing that we're the only side to have taken points off them in the Premier League this season so far. They're unbeaten at Anfield since 2017. April 2017, when they lost to Crystal Palace. So it was a big ask to go there and get anything from Liverpool without Rashford, without Pogba, without McTominay, without a consistent number 10, and go down to a Van Dijk header from zonal marking issues, which we'll cover in a bit. We press for an equaliser, have glorious chances to score and miss all of them. And you know, quite shockingly, Martial and I believe it was Pereira missing obvious chances to score, which you know you'd expect them to actually make. And then in the last minute, Liverpool counter and score a sealing goal, and they look like they're on their way to the title. But we won't dwindle on them. We'll talk about Manchester United. Solskjaer said that was an improvement and an impressive performance, but the result didn't reflect the actual effort used by the effort of the players. So, would you agree with that to a degree, or would you say that it's simply not good enough that Liverpool have won?
Yeah, here's like the frustrating part. That's kind of where we're at as a club. Like, we're so far off the title race. Top four was a goal. Now it's seeming like an impossibility again, even though we're not that far back. It's gotten to the point where, because of injuries, because of the manager's words, because of the ineffectiveness of the board, because of the lack of really desire to win, it seems, from the Glazers, who care more about seemingly making United a brand than winning anything. The expectations are just so low now. Like, I used to go into games, first of all, expecting United to win every single match. Didn't matter where it was, when it was, where it was. You know, kind of thinking, the thought process was kind of like, how are we going to win? Are we going to win 4-0? Are we going to win in Fergie time? You know, are we going to make a roaring comeback? Now it's like, can we just score a goal, you know? And then to go off that performance and really, you know, as the match ended and the final score was 2-0, and I mean, the ultimate reaction was that I was disgusted by it. But back in my head, I'm like, well, they played well. They kind of did. They just didn't score. But it's like, again, that's the function of the expectations. They're just so low. That's my problem with it. I think it's a... I mean, you know, in terms of an individual performance, I mean, they didn't play poorly in the game. They just didn't score. I don't know. What did you think? Did you kind of... Do you think it's just the low expectations that we're at right now, or do you think it's just, I mean, it's just, I don't know. I'm like at a loss here. I can't even, like, I wasn't even mad they lost that game. That's how low people's expectations are. That's how I feel. I don't know. What did you think?
Yeah, I mean, it's one of those games where you go into it and you think Chelsea have just lost, Arsenal have just drawn to Sheffield United, Tottenham have just drawn to Watford. This is a, you know, it's a big game, but they've got nothing to lose in this match, because if they beat Liverpool but lose to Burnley, they're in no better position, really. And losing to Liverpool and losing to Burnley was an even worse position. But my point is that they could have gone on, they could have put everything they had at Liverpool, and they tried to, admittedly. They had great chances, and you can't blame the manager for the players not finishing properly, because, you know, that's something that you just have to do as a player. Pereira has to take that extra step or use his left foot and score that goal. Martial has to let that ball fall onto the floor, and then he can pass it past Alisson, and that's a goal. Fred has to hit the target with that shot that narrowly missed the post. And even in the first half, before Van Dijk scores, James has a great opportunity to pass the ball to Martial, and Martial's through on goal, and one-on-one, he probably scores that. And the pass isn't good enough. There's just those little bits where you think they have that opportunity to do it, and they haven't done it. The tactics of United in that game overall, bar zonal marking, were bang on, inch perfect. Because United actually dominated most of that game. They were Liverpool rampant for a bit. But, I mean, they're always going to be rampant. It's Anfield, it's this Liverpool side, it's that front three. They're always going to have those chances. It's just whether United can take their chances when they have them. And they had enough to win the game. Tottenham had enough to win the game the week before as well. And they bottled that too. So it is difficult to put, you know, say United played well, when if they played well, they would have scored and they should have taken those chances. But there's just something not right about that game. And then, you know, you can just do all you can and you still can't find the net. It is a bit of a, even though they played well, it's still a bit of a shock to them that they haven't scored. So you can look at it both ways and say they played well, but they didn't take their chances. But you can also say they didn't take the chances because they didn't play well, 100% well, in that sense.
I mean, yeah, and I guess that's exactly where I'm at. You know what I mean? Like, where I guess just I'm so beaten down by this season, last few seasons, really, but mainly this season, where it's just like, I mean, like, I guess just look at it this way. Like, are you shocked Martial didn't take his chance? Are you shocked Pereira bottled that? Does Fred ever hit the target? Like, I mean, that's kind of like, I guess it goes back to the expectations. Like, I completely, let's put it this way. If we got anything out of that game, I would have been shocked. You know what I mean? I don't know about you. Even though the way it played out kind of looked like at times we had the better of the play. But I don't know. Just another.
Yeah.
One of those days where it always seems to be the case with us, where we just have something, you know, always something wrong. Either we score some goals, but we can't defend. Or we actually defend pretty well, but we can't score. Mm. It's just always something.
But it's been like that for years, though, hasn't it?
Yeah. It really has.
Yeah, when you think about Van Gaal's reign, you look at all the draws he had. Mourinho in his first season had 11 draws in the Premier League in his first season. Lost 4-0 to Chelsea. Van Gaal had that run of five games where they couldn't get a win. And, you know, lost to Norwich, lost to Bournemouth, lost to Stoke, drew to Chelsea, who are out of form. Hammered by Arsenal, Tottenham, lost to West Ham. That cost us the Champions League. So, you know, every manager has had those kind of losses, especially in their first seasons. So do you think that Solskjaer should be given the time he's requesting?
Well, it's a catch-22. I mean, I think I tweeted this out somewhere, that I think Solskjaer has at times been, you know, an issue in terms of his tactics, but you, like you said, he got him spot on in Liverpool, and I can't argue with that. I think he did a great job with that in terms of putting the players in the right position. But to me, I mean, I've tweeted this out too. Like, it's incredible how Moyes, Van Gaal, Mourinho, Solskjaer, all of them just like forgot how to manage once they got here, right? The problems are so far above him that, I mean, we could get that short term fix. Like if they sack Solskjaer tomorrow and put like a, I don't know, like a Ryan Giggs in charge, or they put like a you know, really anyone associated with the club in charge, you know, you might get that short burst of like form that you kind of got when Solskjaer came in. It was just a different voice and the players were like energized, but ultimately the club is still what the club is. I mean, we still have just a lot of glaring holes throughout the lineup. And I don't know how much of it is fixed by him getting the sack. I mean, I don't know. I feel like he's going to get fired. I think I don't think there's any doubt about that to me. Do you think he's going to, let's put it that way, do you think he's going to get the sack? I think it's almost a foregone conclusion. What do you think?
Well, yeah. I think it's tricky because I feel that had he bought Bruno Fernandes or somebody in at the beginning of January, just after the Arsenal, because they wouldn't have been able to play in the Arsenal game, so we would have lost to Arsenal, that would have happened. You bring somebody in, and then this player, say Bruno Fernandes, would play against Wolves, Manchester City, Norwich, maybe Wolves again if we wouldn't have the replay, Liverpool, and then Burnley. Do you think, it's just whether you think that Bruno Fernandes would have been enough to have impacted all those games there and then? Or maybe Bruno Fernandes and then Boubacary Soumaré, who is that centre midfielder that we've been linked with for ages. Or even, well, and let's not say Jude Bellingham because he's quite a young player, but, you know, or even whatever striker United decide to sign, whether it was Haaland. Would they have made a difference? You'd have to say they would. You'd have to say that Bruno Fernandes would have come in instead of Andreas Pereira in those games. And he probably would have scored that goal against Liverpool. He, you know, Haaland could have come on, made a difference against Man City. Soumaré would have, you know, plugged a hole in midfield where Pereira was, because he certainly wasn't playing well enough. In any game I can remember recently. Maybe, yeah, our set pieces would be a bit, you know, a bit of an issue still. But, you know, set pieces is something that Fernandes has actually been praised for. So maybe, you know, we've actually got someone with a decent delivery of the ball, and that will make a difference to our set pieces. And, you know, it will inspire confidence. If we've got confidence up the field, we'll have confidence at the back as well, that the upfield players can get us through, so they just have to focus on defending and not also playing as an attacker as well. So, yeah.
I mean, ultimately, you bring more talent into the club, you get more better results, right? I mean, that's kind of what you're implying there. That, and I think it's what we're both saying. It's just,
yeah,
we're just lacking quality right now. That's why I wasn't even that angry about the Liverpool game. Because you go into the game, our guys just aren't as good as their guys. That's just the bottom line. As constituted. So when your players aren't better and you're going to their place, you're not going to win most of the time. And that's why actually, you know, the performance, I actually was impressed at times that they were able to control play the way they did. But ultimately, they need more quality. They need to figure out what they want to do. They need to figure out if they really want to be a club that competes for championships, or if they want to just be what they are, which is a mid-table, you know, just up and down, whatever team, which is kind of what we are right now. Some of that's injury. I mean, they've lost a lot of quality. Some of it's, I mean, at times it's been bad tactics, but I think we both think that's far down the list of what the real issues are. Bringing in Fernandes would have helped. Bringing in a striker would help. But, you know, the real big clubs that are competing for things, I don't think, I mean, really, generally, you don't rely on the January transfer window. It's more, that's more of a
backup.
It's a desperation thing to be trying to do something in January, which is why Sporting are demanding so much for Bruno, because they know Jan's desperate. If we were on, you know, if in second place, 6 or 8 points off the lead, you know, knowing we really can't win the league, but firmly in Champions League, we wouldn't need to get Bruno Fernandes, but we're not. So that's kind of, you know, January is tough. It's tough to really improve your team that much in January, I feel. So, man, it's just rough.
Yeah. I did sort of dance around your question about whether Solskjaer should go. But, I don't think he will go before the end of the season. I think he'll be given the time. I think he has to be given the signings, though. He has to be given the backing. The board can say, we back Solskjaer, but they have to show it. They have to show him by giving him the striker, the midfielder, and the number 10 that we need right now. I think he can survive without a left-back till the end of the season. I think Shaw and Williams can do a decent job there just for now. I think right wing, we can survive again. Because it's unrealistic that we're going to get 5 signings in the next 7 days. But if we can survive without a right winger and a left back to the end of the season and then go in for Sancho and Grimaldo, then now we get Fernandes, Sumare and a striker. And then even if we get Bellingham as well, but loan him back, that's something for the future. But we shouldn't be focusing on that in January. January transfer window is the stuff we need right now, which is why, you know, when the last time United had a January transfer window that was successful, it was Juan Mata, and we needed him then. And we've needed him, you know, that whole... He's been successful, I think, since being bought. And that's the thing. You need a right-now player to come in and actually make a difference. And Fernandes will make a difference. You come in for Sumare. He may take time, but he'll make a difference because he'll add bodies, he'll add competition. And he'll add something. The reports today are that Slimani and Odion Ighalo are the strikers that United are looking to loan in. Slimani has scored 7 goals and got 7 assists in 13 Ligue 1 games. And he's a target man. He offers something different. He can play in the European games. He'll give Greenwood someone to feed off. If you want to play 2 strikers up front, he'll be perfect for that too. Odion Ighalo is a quick player. He's a strong player. He does actually have good finishing ability. 10 goals in 17 games in the Chinese League. He is actually a goal scorer. He had an amazing season for Watford, which, you know, that was something that everyone was saying, sign him up. They're players that will make a difference, albeit they're not the quality that United will want for a long term, but they are a short fix while Rashford is out. These are players that will make a difference. It's just whether we can actually, you know, sort them out. And it's whether Ed Woodward can actually be competent for once in his tenure here, actually get the deals that we desperately need so that they can actually show that Solskjaer gets the backing. If they don't get these deals in, we're going to get worse. We've got Chelsea, Man City, Tottenham, Everton, Wolves all to come till the end of March. After March, it's all downhill there. It's all non-Big Six teams that we've got to play. We'll still hopefully be in Europe. We'll still hopefully be in the FA Cup. We may be in the Champions League, but... not in the Champions League. The Carabao Cup final. But it's just whether we can sort it out or not.
Yeah, ultimately, I think your overall point, and I definitely agree with you, is that what we have now is just not good enough to go through all that. It just isn't. There's no depth anymore. I mean, part of it's injury, and injuries happen. And I love when people say injuries are an excuse. I mean, it is. They are an excuse. I mean, you lose quality. We've lost. It's a problem for any club.
Yeah.
But ultimately, you have to have the ability to withstand it. I mean, back in the good old days, which I keep harping on because it's all I have left, we used to basically be able to roll out two squads of 11 that were both pretty capable. You know, the backups were good players. But now it's not the case. I mean, there's some good players. And there's a lot of young talent, which is exciting. But you just, there's a lot of guys here that you just can't be relying on in big moments. Like, guys like Pereira, those were the types of players that would play in FA Cup or would play in, you know, European games when you already have a group clinched. Or, yeah, you know what I mean? But he's being asked to be an every week starter at this point. It's just not, you know, I don't mean to kill the guy. I'm not trying to insult the guy. But Man City and Liverpool and Chelsea, they're not starting a Pereira right now. They're starting much better players than that, you know, on a week-in, week-out basis. We literally don't have a striker. I mean, it's a shot. I mean, besides Greenwood, who's like 18 years old, we have a bunch of guys who can play forward. But Martial's not really a striker. He's more of a winger. Even Greenwood's not really a striker, you know.
He likes that right-hand side.
He's really a winger. I mean, we don't have a target, man. We literally can't. I mean, it's funny. We try to pump balls into the box on corners, but it's like pointless. We don't have a target man capable of winning a header and scoring, except maybe Harry Maguire.
But he hasn't scored yet.
Yeah, he hasn't scored. So
something's wrong.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It sounds stupid, but I never understood why they got rid of Fellaini. I just never understood it. You know, you already overpaid for the guy. He at least would have been useful, you know, late in the match to try to play a header. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
We have no one who could do that now. I really don't understand why they got rid of Lukaku. I don't get any of it, you know. Yeah, it's just, I mean,
yeah,
I'm just at a loss, man. I don't know what to say. Yeah.
Well, the way I see it is that when it comes to Fellaini and Lukaku, I think the fact that Pogba was playing well, the fact that Herrera was playing well, and Matic was playing well at the time, and I don't think Fellaini wanted to play. He could play the way that Solskjaer wanted him to play, and obviously he's not that player. We know that, but he just didn't want to be that kind of player, and he went to, it's not like he went to, you know, Chelsea or Tottenham. He went to China. He didn't upgrade from Manchester United. He went somewhere where he could, you know, let's not beat around the bush, get a lot of money and play a bit of football.
Right, and kind of do what he wants. You know what I mean? Not have to fit within a system.
Yeah, but Lukaku, on the other hand, he just didn't want to play where he was going to play. He didn't want to fight for his place. He wanted to have his place.
Yeah.
And he has his place at Inter because they got rid of Icardi. They got rid of an already well-known, prolific goal scorer who upgraded for PSG, whereas Lukaku sort of flatlined to Inter Milan, but is now scoring goals. I never thought that United wouldn't score goals with Marcus Rashford, Martial, Greenwood and James. I never thought that. I never thought they wouldn't score goals. It's just whether Lukaku would have played that way. He offers something a bit more than what Rashford and Martial does.
That's kind of what I was getting at.
Yeah.
He offers a different look. Like, right now, we have a bunch of guys who play the same way.
Yes. Yeah.
And Lukaku is different. He's a physical presence that's why I kind of would have liked to keep those guys. I mean, maybe it was impossible. Maybe personalities, you don't know how they jive behind the scenes, but those guys offered an opportunity to, okay, we're not able to play through this team. It's not working. Let's try the long ball. Let's try the cross and header thing. Mm-hmm. You know, those guys are both capable of that. We have no way. Basically, Solskjaer goes into a game with certain tactics, and if they don't work, it's just over. Like, it's like, oh, well, those are the tactics. If they're not working, what are you going to do? That's kind of the way we play now.
Yeah.
But it's not good.
No, it's not. You're right. I think if we are linked with Slimani, I'd rather him than Ighalo, because he does offer something a lot more than what Ighalo does. He's actually been playing in one of the top five divisions in the league. In Europe. So I wouldn't be opposed to having him on loan, even though it would cost, I think it's a £4 million loan deal, which is what it is. But if we can get him in there, we can get as an impact player. If we can get Fernandes, apparently the deal's over, it's out because of £10 million. That is the difference between getting Fernandes and not getting Fernandes, is £10 million.
Right.
How do you take that?
Oh, man. See, my whole thing with the transfer window is I don't believe anything I read until they actually are in the 11. So, I mean, ultimately, I think they need to get something done. Even if it's a player who doesn't make much of a difference, yeah, you have to inject some kind of life into this squad. Does that make sense? Like, because right now, the way it is, it's just flat. Like, you keep using the word, and it's accurate. It's just flatlined. It's so dead here. I think any kind of signing would actually invigorate the club. And even if it's just for a short burst. But, and just change the narrative. I think any of those suggestions you make are fine. And the money... I mean, the money doesn't bother me. It's monopoly money, really. This club is so rich. And you know, every year we hear about a record signing. So it's you know, even the Harry Maguire signing, everyone says they overpaid. But, you know, in 2 years, it's going to look like a nothing signing. Like, remember the Van Dijk signing? Everyone thought that was crazy.
Yeah.
And everyone thought the Martial signing was crazy, and now it looks like whatever, you know, it's not, yeah, it just keeps going up and up and up. So none of the money values bother me. It's just actually getting something done. But I mean, so your suggestions are good. I think they got to get something in here, somebody, anybody, just to kind of,
push the rest of the team forward.
Yeah, just to invigorate. Just to get something going. A different storyline other than Solskjaer's terrible, the board's terrible, Woodward's terrible, team. Something other than that, you know? Like, that's basically all the stories I'm reading.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
It's what it is.
Yes.
We'll move just briefly onto the Burnley game, but it will sort of all link into the Liverpool stuff and realistically transfers as well. But a 2-0 loss at home to Old, no, sorry, 2-0 loss at home. The goals were, you have to say, bad defending on Maguire's half.
Yeah,
see the runner both times. I mean, for Rodriguez's stunner, he puts it on his left foot, which is his weak foot. He scores a cracker. That's what it is. But Chris Wood's goal, he lets Chris Wood run past him. So that's something. And then with the Liverpool goal for Van Dijk, yes, zonal markings, I don't agree with it. But he should see the danger of Virgil van Dijk and think, I've got to deal with that. And go in and head the ball and not let Brandon Williams get bullied by Virgil van Dijk. So... That's he's been critical for the first two games. He's been criticised for the first two games of his United captaincy. He's not going to like it any more than we do, but what has to be done for him to succeed?
I mean, I think part of the problem, there's a couple problems. One, like you said, it was just terrible individual defending by what should be a really good defender, right? Mm-hmm. So that's just upsetting right off the bat. And then, but there's like no margin for error here because we literally can't score. So, like, it's just, it's so, they have to be playing with such nerves because it's just so, there's no margin for error. Like, they can't make a mistake. One mistake, and they're done in. And it was, like, I wasn't that angry about the Liverpool game because, yeah, it's Liverpool. You know, this game just
had to win.
Shocking. Say again?
They had to win.
Had to. It was a must win. Or at least compete. You know, I mean, a draw would not have been a great result, but if, you know, if it was a 2-2 draw and Burnley scores two just incredible goals, what can you do? You know, or if it was 2-1 and he scores on that, and I'm blanking. You just said his name, the one who scored the howler,
Rodriguez.
Oh, Rodriguez, yeah, and that draws the game. Whatever, you know, that happens. But yeah, to just be just thoroughly, I mean, I'd have to say thoroughly outplayed. I mean, we had what? Three chances, maybe?
Yeah, we had about three or four good chances to score.
And just like good chances. But ones, you know, I would have been surprised if they were buried, honestly. Yeah. But maybe that's just me, just being so down. I mean, maybe I'm at the point where I just, oh, they scored the goal that was immediately wiped off. And that one was, what did you think about that, actually? The one that was wiped off. Did you catch that one or no?
Which goal, sorry? Oh, the Shaw goal.
Yes.
Yeah. I know Man United Twitter page made a big deal about it, saying, oh, we had one chalked off. But, you know, at the same time, I thought, yes, that's a goal. We can get back from this. But it was a little shove. The Burnley players are clever. They make a big deal out of something like that because they'll know the referee will blow on it. It was a great cross and a great header, but it was a foul in the end. So there's not really much you can do about that. So
yeah, I mean, initially I thought he was ruled offside, which I thought was crazy. I was like, he's way offside. And then I saw that the referee was sort of indicating that it was a push.
Yeah.
And I mean, I thought it was a little ticky-tack. I mean, that happens all the time.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
But like you said, that only would have made it 2-1. There was no way they were going to get a second anyway. So, but, because I believe there was what, maybe like 3 or 4 minutes left?
Yeah.
When that happened. But it just, I mean, you know what? The way I look at it is this. The Liverpool match, they actually played with intent. This match, they look
lethargic.
Yeah, I was going to say disinterested, but lethargic's better. Like, they just, like, they were outplayed. It's almost like they thought, okay, well, you know, we almost scored against Liverpool. We played really well against them. We'll just go out and, you know, we're playing Burnley now, so we'll just do the same thing and we'll win this time. And then they didn't do anything.
Yeah.
That was shocking.
Yeah.
Absolutely shocking.
Mm-hmm.
Just an awful performance. I mean, one of the worst of the season. It's getting to the point where
each loss is the worst of the season.
He's right. You're right. Like, we keep saying, oh, that's the worst performance of the year. And then it happens again.
And again.
And again.
Yeah.
I mean, even needing two legs, really, to beat Wolves and FA Cup. I mean, come on. I mean, this is like insane.
Wolves are a decent team, to be fair. They gave Liverpool a run for their money.
Yeah.
But,
oh, Lord.
At the same time, we had enough chances to win that game in the first
game. Oh, of course. But that's what I mean. We never bury chances. Ever.
We need about 20 shots to get 3 goals.
That's about accurate.
Yeah.
We're almost like a hockey team. Like, it's awful.
Yeah.
It's awful.
Well, to be fair, in hockey, the goals are a lot smaller. So there's
at least
excuse for hockey.
Yeah, right. And they take like 50 shots a game. So, yeah. But this is just, oh my gosh.
Yeah, it's just baffling. But yeah, so we'll just quickly brush on the next two matches. Tranmere Rovers in the FA Cup. I've seen the pitch. It's not great. It reminds me a bit of, if you remember, Rostov in the Europa League.
Oh, wow. Okay, yeah. That's not good.
I mean, not to that degree, but like it's quite similar. United have to win the game. It is a must. You have to say it is a must win, because if they lose or draw, it's going to be curtains. Do you think he's going to make a lot of changes, or do you think he's going to keep some of the important players in and go from there?
I think he's going to have to make a lot of changes, because I think at this point, we have such little depth, and like you laid out a few minutes ago, we just don't have the depth to deal with all the fixtures that are coming, and the important ones. Not that this match isn't important. It is. I mean, the FA Cup probably is our last chance for silverware, honestly. And we have to win, but we have to figure you can get by that team with a backup team. But because you can't keep running out we only have like 11 our top side now with all the injuries, and if we don't have any signings, we don't have any depth. We only have like 11 guys and maybe two other players that could really make a difference, and the rest are really squad players. So I think they have to make a lot of changes, just because at some point we need rest. We've played a lot of games. What is it, something like 5 games in 10 get in 10 days or something like that?
Yeah. So.
So there needs to be rest, but they can't bottle this game. I mean, this would be just another nail in Solskjaer's coffin if we end up, you know, having to play. Well, actually, is it fourth? I forget. The FA Cup changes every year. So what's the deal now? Is it replays?
I think there's replays for the first two, the first four rounds. So we played in the third round, and this is the fourth round. Then after the fourth round, no more replays. It's just, I think, extra time and penalties.
So at this point, it's extra time and penalties, or at this point,
you can still get a replay at Old Trafford.
Okay. And then next year they'll probably change it.
You'd hope so, because replays are terrible.
Yeah. And they change the rules every year.
Yeah.
I didn't know away goals weren't a thing in the Carabao Cup anymore.
I didn't know that until we lost 3-1 at home.
Yeah.
Slightly relieving.
Yeah, I mean, I thought, I don't know. They change everything all the time. But, like, wait, what did we decide? That there would be a replay if they draw?
Yeah, there's a replay, yeah.
So could you imagine having a replay with this team? I mean, it's possible. Because they're going to try for the nil-nil. You know they're going to try for the nil-nil.
Yeah, yeah, of course. But
we can't score, so
we might be able to score with our backup team. With
I hope so.
Players to
What do you think? I mean, there is an argument to playing the best guys to try to get some confidence back.
Yeah, I can see what you mean. The thing is, what I feel is that with the team playing as poorly as they are in big areas, so number 10. Out wide. I think Martial will stay as a striker till somebody else can come in, because he does offer a lot of creativity. That he's had two bad games, so I'm not fussed about that. But out wide, James has not been performing week in, week out. Greenwood is still a little, he's young, so there is room for, he might have issues starting week in, week out. Pereira's not good enough. Lingard, Mata, Pereira in the number 10, even Gomez, that's all up for grabs. I think Matic's place might be up for grabs as well because he's played less than average. The back four will probably stay the same and the goalkeeper will rotate for cup competitions. But everywhere else, there are positions available. And Fosu-Mensah's back. He can play in midfield. He might have a start. Chong, Gomez, who are, you know, either waiting for contracts or trying to attract Europe's best with their contracts running out in the summer. They'll want to, you know, show off. Lingard needs some confidence. Pereira could do with confidence. Greenwood could start and do with a goal. James could do with a goal. They've got to think that this is Tranmere Rovers. We could put six past them if we play our best. You know, that's what they've got to think about. They've got to have that mentality to think we can play amazing football when we want to. Let's put it on. Let's get a big result and go into that Carabao Cup full of confidence. That's what I think should happen.
Yeah, I believe, and I definitely hear you. I think that's a good, that's a very good point. I think that, you know, it's, on the one hand, you need rest for players. But on the other, we really need to get confidence back. Mm. And we, at this point, have none. I mean, it has to be. I mean, it's hard to say from a million miles away whether a team has confidence, but just watching how they play, they don't look like a team with any confidence right now.
Yeah.
I mean, the worst result would be to put our best side out.
And lose.
Or get a nil-nil.
Yeah.
And be like, okay, we just literally cannot score a goal against anyone.
Yeah.
So.
It would be horrendous.
Horrendous, absolutely.
I think there's three games left till the international break, then we've got to go and play Chelsea. So these three games, three different competitions, United have to win all three. They have to, even if they don't get through to the next round of the Carabao Cup, they have to beat City and say, we're back. Because if they lose, they'll go to Wolves, they'll play at home to Wolves and lose that too. Because it is a domino effect. And I think if you play the full strength team, three games in a row, maybe a few changes for the FA Cup, but full strength team the next two games and just say, put everything you've got for this next 10 days, put everything you can possibly go through. We're going to try and get players in the meantime, try and get a boost. And then you have that 10 days break with your international team or your training with the normal squad back at Carrington. You have that. And then you go and play Chelsea and you just bottom. You go to the bridge, you show you mean business. Chelsea've got the next three games. They've got Leicester, they've got us, and I think they've got Manchester City. They've got three games where they've got to get points and United have to get points. And, you know, the whole top four race can fluctuate in a blink of an eye. United have to give everything they have in these next three games. They could still be in three, the race for top four, FA Cup and the Carabao Cup, they'd be in the final. If they give everything they possibly can. And that's all you can ask from these players. And even though there's not enough quality there, they still, you know, they can still shock you. So I feel they have to just put everything out and then they can have a rest. Then they have those 10 days to get back into form, get back into fitness and play against Chelsea. That's what it is for me.
Yeah. That's a good way to put it. I mean, it really is. I mean, I think the way you're saying it is true. I think it really is kind of put up or shut up time for this squad. Like the next 10 days, like going or so before the international break, they have to start. They have to have something to cling to during that international break. Right now, it's just negativity and anger and frustration and
sickness.
And it's, yeah, all that stuff. Mm. It's just terrible.
Yeah. Right. Well, we're not going to talk about the Carabao Cup for much longer. There is one thing I'd like just to ask you before we finish for the day. If United don't get any signings, there's two questions. Firstly, how much will the fans turn on Ed Woodward and the board even more because of it? And secondly, in all the respective competitions where United are in right now, they've got Club Brugge in the Europa League, in the Carabao Cup they've got Manchester City, in the FA Cup they've got Tranmere and however far they get after that, and in the Premier League for the rest of the top four, how will they finish in all those competitions?
Wow. Okay, so I think without any more signings, and assuming we don't get anyone back healthy, I think Carabao Cup is nearly lost at this point. Even with a signing, I think it's going to be tough.
Yeah,
they're already down 2 goals against a better team, and they're going to their building, and we already won there one time, playing literally a perfect counter game, which I don't see how we're going to do that again. That was just almost like everything went perfectly for us in that match. So I think, unfortunately, that match is done. FA Cup, I think they can make a run at FA Cup, because I think at some point the FA Cup becomes the tournament where there's always one big squad that makes the final and one kind of squad that's having a bad year other than the FA Cup, because at some point the other squads can't focus on every single competition. It's just too much. So we really don't have Europe to worry about much, except for Europa, which is another story. But we don't have Champions League, so we're not playing these top sides with, you know, that are, you know, tough games. We're not really playing that yet. And then Carabao Cup will have been over, so that'll be done. So I really think, even with no more signings, I can see the squad as constituted, just because of the nature of the competitions, making a run in either Europe or FA Cup, one or the other. I think it's more likely to be FA Cup, just because there's less variables. But what do you think? I think they'll make a run in one of those competitions.
Yeah. It's difficult to say which one. It depends on who we get in the next legs. I think we should get past Tranmere. I think we will get past them well. I think against Club Brugge, we should do well. They haven't got the best team in the world. They do cause a few problems, but I feel like we have enough to get past them quite well. It's whether we get someone difficult in the FA Cup, someone difficult in the Europa League, then we'll choose who plays where. If we get difficult in both, we're a bit screwed in that sense. But you've got to have a bit of luck. You've got to have a bit of... you've got to have a lot of quantity, but you're going to have a little bit of luck on your side. You're going to have to... And it also depends on where we are in the Premier League. If we're still fighting for that top four, I think we go for the FA Cup. I think if we're dead and buried in the top four, Chelsea run away with it, we're 9 or 10 points away from them by the first leg of the Europa League, we go for the Europa League, because then that's Champions League, and then that's more signings, that's more revenue for Woodward to say, oh, we've got more revenue, we can get better players, that kind of level of nonsense lies. But because we can get any player we wanted to if we wanted to. So
right. Yeah, I never understood that. And even the whole, this guy wants to play Champions League football. Like, I hear that excuse all the time. And I think in some cases, that's true to an extent. But I also feel like, you know, if it's, you know, a player who has a chance to play Champions League football at Liverpool or Europa with United, but United's offering him, you know, triple his wages, he's coming to United. You know what I mean? So... Mm. I always think money talks in the end. And we kind of saw... Yeah.
Yeah. Well, yeah. It's just whether we... I feel like we might finish... These next few games in the Premier League are going to be vital. If we can get victories or positive results in all of them, we stand a chance of getting in the top four, I think. But we have to have a signing. At least one. Ideally three. But at least one. And at least a number 10. I think we can do without a striker if we get a number 10. I think with a striker, we could just about survive with what we've got, but at the same time, I'd rather get Fernandes in. He'll make a massive... He won't change the game, but he'll make a massive difference. But it's you know, it's just recycling the same points we've been saying since the summer. But,
yeah.
It's just... The bottom line is we need signings, and it's not Solskjaer's fault. He's told everyone who he told Woodward who he wants, and I'm sure the Glazers have said the money's there, but I don't know. I honestly have no information on how much of an impact they have on the club. Apparently, Joel Glazer said no to Fernandes. Apparently, Woodward said no to Fernandes. The bottom line is Solskjaer's not to blame for the signings. It's somebody else higher up. And we've been saying that for years.
Right. That was the case with Mourinho, too. And everyone always, you know, says, you know, what does Mourinho have to complain about? They signed 11, 10 guys, whatever it was, during his tenure. And all that's true. But it's not so much the signings. It's since Alex Ferguson has left, none of our managers get what they want. They get people. They get, they get players. I mean, yeah, you're always going to sign somebody. It's football. There's movement. There's player movement. Mm-hmm. Players' contracts run out. You know, other players just, you know, find their way into your squad. It's the nature of the game. But I don't think any of them have gotten what they've wanted as a top choice. I mean, even now, reading between the lines, and again, it's hard to figure out what's real and what's not. I think Solskjaer definitely wants Bruno Fernandes here. Definitely.
Yeah.
And it's not happening. So, you know, that's kind of where we're at.
You just have to see that, you know, what will almost certainly happen is if Solskjaer stays in the job in the summer, which is not a guaranteed certainty, which is disappointing from a kind of just in general, it's just disappointing that that's where we're at. But if we do wait to the summer, he'll go. And he'll probably go for 10 million more than we wanted in this than we wanted now, and probably 20 million more than we wanted last summer. So it's just the same thing happening with the Harry Maguire thing. I'm pretty sure we wanted Di Maria a year before as well. We wanted Pogba. I don't know if we wanted Pogba the year before. I'm not sure about that. But you know, we needed a defender for a year. We needed a right back for a year, and we didn't get it. We got Dalot, but he was always going to be one for the future, which is what Mourinho said from the beginning. But we needed another right back. We waited a year for a left back. We still haven't got it. We basically not replaced Mkhitaryan as a number 10. And that's been, it's been 2 years now?
Yes.
2 years since Mkhitaryan left? Maybe 2 years yesterday? So
yeah, because we had Sanchez for about a year and change.
So,
yep.
2 years yesterday, we've not replaced our number 10 that had, you know, started the year as the number 10. So it's negligent on, you wouldn't say it's negligent on either Mourinho or Solskjaer, because I'm pretty sure they've told the board who they want to sign. And they've said, these are the players I want, go and get them for me. I can build you a good team. And they just haven't delivered. And it's the same thing we've been saying the last five managers. If you can include
one. Yeah.
Yeah. And nothing is going to change unless... the thing is, the Glazers won't leave. I've said for ages, the Glazers won't leave unless someone buys the club from them. They're stuck here. The person that will leave, hopefully, is Ed Woodward. Or he won't be involved in the football side. Get someone in like Campos from Marseille, or Lyon even. Van der Sar from Ajax. Someone, anyone who actually has a footballing brain, something that both Van Gaal and Mourinho have said that Woodward lacks, and you get that person in and they make the deals. That is all you have to do. And you get the fans a little bit, more of the fans on your side. You get the players that we need. You get the fans cheering United again. I saw what happened in the Burnley game. People leaving after 75 minutes. It was dreadful.
Yeah, it's 100% what needs to happen. I mean, it's just, you're spot on. Like, it's not even, I mean, I don't know how you could defend, I don't know how anybody can defend Woodward. I don't understand how it's possible. I don't get it.
I don't think anyone is.
Yeah, I mean, that's what I mean. I don't think it's what he's done here is with the resources he has to have where this team is where it's at. It's just mind-boggling.
Mm.
Like almost by accident, they should have a good squad, you know, with the money that they splash around. But they don't. It's just been horrible for years now.
Yeah,
and you have to say, even the teams that did well, like Mourinho's treble team with the FA Cup and the Carabao Cup and the Europa, the squad that finished second, you know, about a year and a half ago, the squad that was the FA Cup final, it's been like smoke and mirrors to do that. It's been like, you know what I mean? It's been like grinding out results that you just are kind of shocked by, you know.
Made far too difficult. We could have done
exactly.
Yeah.
Like, we have had so few. I mean, this is the way I would look at it. The bottom line is, I go into every game now worried. There were games I was expected to win every game, you know, when the team was very good. But there were games where I literally would have, like, you know, I know it doesn't work this way with the way prices work with bets, but literally would bet the house on. Like, there's no chance in the world we're losing this game. You know, now they're going to third division club?
League One, yeah.
League, yeah. And I'm scared to the death of the game.
Yeah.
And it's a game years ago. You know, we would be like, all right, this is going to be 4-1, 4-0, 5-0, you know, 6. You know, how many are we going to score? I'd be happy if they got out of there with a 2-0. That's how low my expectations are, you know? Even the Burnley game, I was confident we'd beat Burnley. But still, you know, the fact they lost, I'm not shocked. I wasn't shocked by it. Were you shocked by it? I wasn't. I was like, that happens this year, you know.
I was shocked by the loss, but only, you know, if I'd have been told at the beginning of the game we were going to go in and we're going to lose 2-0, I'd have thought, I don't believe you. After watching the first 20 minutes and seeing us miss about 5 chances, I thought, yeah, we're definitely going to lose now. It's just not going to happen.
Or at least... Okay, I'll put it this way. I'm surprised we lost. A draw would not have shocked me at all.
Yes.
Even the least bit. Yeah. Not even a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
But that's where we're at.
It's just so,
it's like I said at the top of the podcast, our expectations are just so low.
Yeah.
Like, I got out of the Liverpool game going, well, all right, well, at least we didn't get embarrassed 5-0.
Yeah.
You know,
well, we could have done.
That's kind of how the thought process is now.
Mm-hmm.
Even the Man City game, like the first leg of the Carabao Cup, like it's 3-0, and for it to end 3-1, it was kind of like, all right, well, that could have been a lot worse.
And we're still slightly in it.
Right. Or you convince yourself, right?
Yeah, maybe.
But, you know what I mean? Like, that's just kind of like where we're at as a squad. We're just... It's just horrible. There's no other way to put it. I'm trying to come up with another way, but there just isn't, you know? So, that's where we're at. I mean, it's just... Well, no end in sight, really.
Yeah, I know. It is a really, really sad state to be in for a club of this stature. But it's what it is. We just have to move on to the next game keep supporting them, and yeah. hopefully they can turn things round with a few signings and with a few goals against Tranmere Rovers, which is not what I was hoping would be a turn point.
Yeah, I can't believe it's like you can't believe you're saying that sentence out loud, right?
I know. It sounds absurd, but
it's yeah. But that's another subtle point. I mean, you're dead on right there, you know, to say, you know, keep supporting the club. And I wholeheartedly agree with you. I've seen a lot of stuff flying around social media where people are like, I'm not going to watch anymore. I'm not going to support this anymore. It's got nothing to do with the... Go ahead.
Hoping the team loses so that the manager goes.
Yeah, I don't understand that at all. I mean, I don't get it. And again, it's not the players' fault. There's nothing wrong with, I mean, the players themselves, they can't help but be who they are. It's not their fault. They're not.
They can only offer so much.
Yeah, it's not, you know, Lingard and Pereira's fault that they're not Messi and Ronaldo. You know what I mean? They're just not those players. So, I still love every player on the squad. And it's just not good. That's the bottom line.
Well, that's one summary of Manchester United that everyone can agree with. It's not good. But
they're just not good. That is the hard hitting analysis that we bring to you at the United Devils Pod. They're just not good.
Oh dear. I'm afraid that is all we have time for this week. Thank you for listening, and thank you once again to Jayson for joining me.
No problem. Thanks for having me.
It's a pleasure to have you. Tune in next week, in which we will be hoping for some more positive results against Tranmere and hopefully in the Carabao Cup semi-final. And we'll be looking at those results as well as looking ahead to United's next game against Wolves in the Premier League. If you have any questions or any topics you would like for us to discuss, then please comment below on the YouTube video or on the Twitter or Facebook post. And if you like this, please subscribe to our channel and follow us on Twitter for all of our content.